Hallelujah. Christ is risen. Yes, hallelujah. We have come together to worship on this beautiful morning as we celebrate the resurrection of Christ the Lord. The bulletin is given in loving memory of Myrna Bischoff Rich's birthday by Herb and Janie Bischoff, Jennifer, Britt, Alex, and Nick Robertson, and also given in loving memory of their parents, Thelma and Rich Cease, and Rose and Robert Douglas by Veronica and Dave Douglas. The two large Easter lilies are on the altar are given in honor of her family, friends, and church family by Karen Orr. Thank you to Greg Young for serving as liturgist, to Allison Reynolds for serving as acolyte, and to Chris McMillan for serving as guest organist today. In our notices for the month, our random acts of kindness. A little explanation of that. April, our mission of the month is random acts of kindness. Now we are, some are planning perhaps to go to Du Bois on the 29th, when they have a work day and do an act of kindness by helping with creation and preparation for the season. Other ways that, you know, maybe you're not into trying to remove invasive plants and things. Maybe you can help a neighbor and remove their invasive bugs or something like that, or the branches and twigs that have come down. Maybe there's a way that you can make phone calls, that you could send some extra notes. Maybe there's somebody that just is on your heart and you don't even know why, but they're on your heart, send them a note or give them a call. These random acts of kindness are really ways that we share the joy of resurrection and God's love. So keep that in mind for April especially and forever. In our hanging basket sale, the orders are due by April 11th. There's order forms in the narthex, and they can be accepted till the 23rd, but really could get a pretty good count by the 11th. That would be helpful. And you can pick them up on Friday, May 12th, and Saturday, May 13th, so they make great Mother's Day gifts. In April, the end of April, we will be having a free contemporary Christian concert here in the sanctuary, and that will be just a goodwill offering for the musicians during the concert time. But beforehand, there will be a dinner, and you can make reservations for the dinner, up to 80 people, and that we do need reservations to have things in line like we hope to have them. So anyone can come to the concert, and if you choose to come to the dinner, please make reservation. And let's see, in our calendar for the week, today the children will be with me in just a minute, and we'll do a little something special for Alleluia, and then the children will share something with us, and they will go to Sunday school. And then after this service, there is fellowship hour sponsored by the council. Tomorrow the office is closed, but Brotherhood will meet at 6:30. And Tuesday, Hilltoppers are 12:30, and the cemetery meeting is 6 o'clock. It was moved because it originally would have been on Monday, Thursday. So it was moved till Tuesday, and at 6 o'clock on this Tuesday. Wednesday is pretty much the regular schedule. Thursday is the council meeting at 6, and next Sunday will be, again, worship and Sunday school at 9:30. And in our, let's see, that takes care of the announcements parts. Unless there is someone else who has something, which I know Kiki is, since this is council's fellowship hour, Kiki will tell us more about that.
I was going to tell you what council was, but I decided to tell you who council is in our church. So our council vice president is Donna Brandis. Donna leads worship and fellowship Christian education committee for our church. Her genuine love for our church's youngest members is evident every Sunday morning as they attend worship together. Donna also works to organize our annual sausage dinner, serves on the budget and finance and nominating committees. Secretary Amy Alsup, also known as May Lee's mom, amazes us with her fast typing and concise minutes for our meeting. She also works diligently as the chair of pastoral relations and personnel, making sure our employees are treated fairly and helping us in our continuing search for a music director. She also serves on the Budget and Finance Committee and the Cemetery Committee. Treasurer Mike Siebold, besides being the guy who's always coming up with great ideas like flower sales, barbecues, craft fairs, concerts, also serves as chair of the Evangelism, Special Funds, Outreach, and Stewardship. So if you hear people referring to ESOS Committee, that's what we are referring to. He's also treasurer of the Building and Grounds Committee and chair of the Budget and Finance Committee. Council is also Becky Kriegel, who serves as the chair for Altar Guild and the Ushering Committee. She's the person who will be looking for three new council members later this year as the chair of the Nominating Committee. And Dorothy Kenny, who brings us knowledge and insight from St. Peter's UCC and her organizational skills as she serves on the Cemetery Committee and ESOS. Dorothy also serves as a liaison for a new church community alliance being formed in Granite City. Council is also Dave Douglas, part of our technical team and the face of Zoom. But Dave also serves as chairman of both Cemetery and Building and Grounds Committee. Dave is often the one behind the first greeting or handshake visitors receive as they enter our sanctuary. That leaves our two newest members, Beth Partney and Garrett Garner. Beth has tackled the duties of both Cemetery Committee and Pastoral Relations and Personnel. Beth has graciously volunteered to help in many capacities and has brought enthusiasm and interest to her position. Garrett has accepted positions on Building and Grounds and Worship Fellowship Christian Ed Committees. He does this while also serving on our Sunday school staff as Donna's right-hand man. So you see, council is not a what, it is the who of our church. And I hope you take time to thank these hard workers that work for the betterment of our congregation. And I also hope you join us at the end of this year when the nominating committee are looking for three new members. Come and have donuts on us after church too, please.
Thank you. If there are no more announcements, then let us listen to the bells calling us to worship and the prelude centering our hearts on worship.
the children. Today, we have a book, and I'm just going to look at the second to the last page, but I'm going to hold it so some of you can see this. It says, 3 days after his Jesus, that'd be death, Jesus' friends were surprised to see the stone rolled away from his grave and an angel sitting on it. Jesus is not here, the angel said. He is risen. He is risen. That's what we're celebrating today, that Jesus is risen. And on the in the bulletin in the center here, it says, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. And that is a saying of the church. So if I would say, Christ is risen, Charles will say, Alleluia. Or if I say, Alleluia, Christ is risen, he will say, Christ is risen indeed. Yes, that is a response for generations and generations that has been used in the church. And that is a response that tells us what the psalmist had said. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. So your great-great-great-grandparents were probably saying, Christ the Lord is risen today. They were singing that. They were saying, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. It's been shared over and over. And the songs and stories that you share, you may well share with your children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren someday. What a wonderful time this is. And so if I say, when I say Christ is risen, I'd like you to say back, Christ is risen indeed. Okay? Christ is risen. Okay, let's do it again and loud enough so they can hear you. Christ is risen. Yes. What a wonderful message for the children, from the children to all of you. And so let us pray. Oh God, we thank you for this day. We thank you that you have raised your son and that he has brought us life, that he has brought us new life. We thank you for all your blessings, for the gifts you share with us, the gifts we share with one another, the gifts the children share with us as we all continue to grow in faith. Receive our worship. Receive our worship, for Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Amen.
This is the day, let's clap our hands. Clap our hands, for this Easter day, let's clap our hands.
Please join with us in the responsive call to worship and prayer. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Alleluia, Christ is risen indeed.
Christ is alive.
Moving among the living.
Christ is risen.
Inviting us to rise in fullness of life.
Christ is calling.
Proclaiming life and hope for all.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Alleluia, Christ is risen indeed.
Let us pray.
Risen Christ, enter our worship and our hearts this day. As you live and move among us, remind us to proclaim and live the life you offer. Inspire us to walk as children of your resurrection each and every day. Amen.
Let us join in the litany of confession and mercy. On this day of resurrection, we remember the high expectations God has of us. We are called away from our frantic distractions to recognize the Creator of all things. God, who shows no partiality, invites us to be witnesses to the good news of Jesus Christ among all whom we meet.
God, we have lost our awe of you in the busyness of our day. We have forgotten to look for Christ in the people we meet. We have ignored your mandate to live as Christ in relation to our neighbors. On this day of resurrection, We ask you to raise us up and restore in us a commitment to our risen Savior. May we die to all that is selfish in order that Christ may live in us. Amen.
God answers our prayers and offers us salvation. In following Christ, we find wholeness and joy. We set our minds on God's gracious intentions for us. Give thanks to God, whose steadfast love endures forever. Rejoice that Christ sends us out to tell others and that they too may know the resurrection joy. Seated.
The New Testament lesson this morning comes from Acts chapter 10, verses 34 through 43. Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every people, anyone who fears him and practices righteousness is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name.
Thank you.
Our first gospel lesson today is from Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 10. Listen for the good news of the gospel. After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descending from heaven came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him.' This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers and sisters to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." Thanks be to God for this lesson. May the Holy Spirit inspire the presentation and hearing of this reflection, that we might learn to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, strength, and mind, and our neighbors as ourselves. Amen. "He is not here, for he has been raised." What astonishing yet wonderful words the women heard on our first Easter morning. Yes, Jesus had told them himself what would come to pass, but how could they understand the seemingly impossible? Yet Mary Magdalene and the other women, depending on which gospel we are reading, heard the angel declare that it was possible and that it was true. "He is not here, for he has been raised." The agony of betrayal by one and by the crowds, the agony of injustice and mockery, the agony of beating and death on a cross, all overcome by resurrection and new life. "He is not here, for he has been raised," the angel declared, and everything changed for the faithful women at the empty tomb. They had expected to care for Jesus' lifeless body as religious rules required. Instead, they were told to break from religious rules and go find the men and tell them the wondrous news. He is not here, for he has been raised. Jesus himself told them to go and tell the others, to proclaim the good news there in Jerusalem and in Galilee and eventually in all the world. And that is why we are here today. Because they did go. They did go, they did tell, and they did proclaim the good news. They and the rest of the disciples and followers who had been with Jesus, and the seekers and curious ones who became believers through what they heard proclaimed, all told the world the good news of resurrection life. Alleluias then and alleluias now continue around the world. How wonderful it is that everyone in God's creation is invited to hear the good news, invited to believe the good news. The disciple Peter preached that truth in the early church, saying, "I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every people, anyone who fears, honors, respects him, and practices righteousness is acceptable to him." Again, we are here today because no matter what our heritage or life has been and is, we believe the good news that Jesus has been raised and lives for all. The disciple Peter could never have imagined that the United States of America would ever exist. But here we are today, believing the same good news the women proclaimed to Peter and the others. Here we are today, where all God's people are welcome to come together in worship and raise the rafters with alleluias, where all God's people do not look the same or live the same or even believe exactly the same, yet all rejoice to also proclaim that Jesus has been raised. And that is wonderful good news to share. For the church is not a closed community or exclusive club. The church is all God's people, filled with the Spirit and actively following Jesus. How we follow, that varies among believers, but we all follow Jesus. Perhaps in the early years of the Christian church, there were those who knew only the Gospel of Mark, the first written, and others only Matthew or Luke, the next, and later John. Each of the gospel writers tell of Jesus' mission and of his life on earth, each telling it in his own way, as he has heard it from others or from shared sources many years later. And thus, there are variations in the Gospels, as the Holy Spirit inspired each writer, and each told the good news as it related to his experience. Today, I have read Matthew's resurrection story with the key proclamation from the angel being, "He is not here, for he has been raised." In a few minutes, as we prepare for the Sacrament of Communion, I will read a portion of John's resurrection story with the key proclamation from Mary, who came to the tomb alone, being, "I have seen the Lord. I have seen the Lord." Two different participants in the resurrection story, each proclaiming the same message that Jesus is not dead. He is risen. It is the message that gives the good news, no matter who first spoke it or who speaks it today. In Matthew, the women take hold of Jesus' feet to worship him. In John, Mary is told not to touch Jesus because he has not yet ascended. Often we do not know why the details vary, but the message ultimately is the same good news. Jesus is alive again. He is raised from the dead. And there is hope and promise for all through his resurrection. From the perspective of the women at the tomb in Matthew's gospel, there is fear all around. After all, you know, the guards faint from fear in the great earthquake, and an angel from heaven like lightning appears. Yes, there is reason to fear, but what do the women hear? They hear the angel say, "Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Even though your world is turned upside down, your grief over the death of Jesus is great, and you do not know what is coming next as you take the risk of coming to the tomb. Do not be afraid." From the women's perspective, there is plenty of fear to share, but they are willing to do what is needed. The angel's words and then Jesus' greeting and instructions are unexpected, but wow, what good news. Perhaps that is where we are today. Here, we may not fear coming to worship, or we might, if we are unsure of what to do or how we will be received. So maybe there is fear, possibly. But God's good news is shared through welcomes for the whole world, through a welcome, good news shared through welcome without partiality. Today we may not faint from the unexpected, but we have likely all been shocked by unexpected news or tragedy in our personal and public lives. And we still hear, "Do not be afraid," because Jesus is raised and new life is possible. In this time together, we may not see Jesus and hear his instructions, but we do follow them as our communion table declares. We do this in remembrance of me. We do remember Jesus. We remember his life-giving gifts, and we do tell others. Thus, we are the women at the tomb. We are the women at the tomb and the ones who have come to believe through their story told over and over again. We are part of that story as we tell it out today and every day, as we tell our story that is the old, old story. Fear is overcome because death is overcome. The powers of evil are overcome. The good news is greater than ever. The truth is still true. He is not here, for he has been raised. Alleluia and amen.
Thank you.
As we begin our time of prayer, we extend our Christian sympathy to the family of Leonard Schaefer, who died on Sunday, April 2nd, 2023. A funeral service was held here on Saturday, April 8th. May the peace and comfort that come from God sustain his loved ones during this time of grief. And I am also sorry to say that Mildred Kennison has died on Friday. Her obituary is posted on the Irwin Chapel webpage. The service will be held at Jefferson Barracks on April 17th, a week from tomorrow. And we continue to remember those in nursing and assisted and independent living: Earl Binger, Marsha Binger, Ruth Buer, Hildy Few, Joanne King, Karen Ludicky, Marjorie Schmidt, and Jerry Schank. And at home, Chloe Affalter, Isabella Boyer, Carol Braunmeyer, Christopher Clark, Myra Cook, Bonnie Fornicheski, Mary France, Lucard Fries, Melba Grady, Lou Hassey, Norman Henty, Chuck King, Mina McBrien, Cindy Meyer, Sandy Mueller, Cliff Robertson, Merle Rose, June Stilley, and Nancy Wilson. And in the Illinois South Conference, Pena United in Faith Church, Reverend Leon Goff, and Pinckneyville St. Paul UCC, Reverend Jason Isley, and retired pastor, Reverend Jean Carmian. And also, are there additional concerns or celebrations in the congregation or on Zoom? Well, I begin preparation Wednesday for surgery on Thursday. The hospitalization is to be 5 to 7 days. And my husband, Reverend Charles Preston, will fill in and be available as needed for emergencies. So call the office, call Kiki, call our home phone number to contact him. Call my cell phone, not on Thursday, because yeah, surgery is supposed to be 5 hours or so, or a bit more with other things. So Thursday, I probably won't hear the phone. And but I look forward to a full recovery and return soon. And there was another Kara. Kara's daughter-in-law, sister, so that would be Beth, Christine's sister Beth, has been taken to the rushed to the hospital, and they don't really have results yet.
And my joy is that Drew is 3 years old today.
Oh. Her joy is that her grandson Drew is 3 years old today. What a wonderful celebration. Any Zoom? Understand, last week I missed a couple, so. Charles? Oh, yes. My stepsister, I got a text last night. She's been fighting cancer for quite a while, for those who don't know. And they've made the decision that Monday they're going to contact hospice. So that's where it stands now. They made that decision once before and then didn't follow through, but it seems like this time that is the route they will need to take. So let us be in a spirit of prayer. God of amazing surprises, the story of Easter is both old and new at once. Suddenly we are aware of your presence among us, as you awaken something new within us this Easter morn. We hear the good news. He is not here, for he has been raised, and join the celebration. We raise our glad songs, giving thanks that Easter is here again. Hope is alive again. The troubles and sorrows of the past year are met by Jesus' comforting words. Do not be afraid. And so we pray with confidence. We pray for healing and for peaceful dying in due time. We pray for mercy and reconciliation and for the strength to take the steps of repentance and forgiveness. We pray for ourselves and our loved ones, as well as for people we do not know well and for those we don't really like, that your Spirit may draw us together as you intend. We pray for the leaders of the world, our nation and state, and our communities, that your Spirit may guide them into wise and just decisions. We pray for those who serve for the good of all in every way that helps others. We pray for our brothers and sisters of other faiths and of no chosen faith, believing that you can and do work in the hearts of all your children, sharing your love with all, without partiality. May the Alleluias of today ring out around the world and bring peace. This and all our prayers we offer in the name of Jesus, the risen Christ, now and forever. Amen. Gifts today in the special Easter envelopes and our regular offering envelopes will be given to the general fund of the church, that we might continue to be a faithful witness and sharing the good news of God's love in all the world. Let us give with joy.
Thank you.
Please join me in the unison prayer of dedication. We have heard the message the disciple Peter proclaimed long ago, O God, the message of peace by Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. May our gifts spread this message of salvation to the ends of the earth. With these offerings, we also give ourselves and dedicate our lives to discipleship. Make us unafraid to go and tell the good news of your mercy and share the joy with all. Amen.
And now we hear from the Gospel of John. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabbuna," which means teacher. And Jesus said to her, "Do not touch me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." And Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. And in Luke's gospel, we read that Jesus, at the table with two of the disciples, took bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them, and their eyes were opened, and they recognized the risen Christ in the breaking of the bread. And so today we sit before the Lord's table, and also know his presence with us through the eyes of our heart. It is the Lord who invites all the people of God to come and share in his gifts and receive life. Therefore, we come in unity. We come as we are to partake and share. This table is spread for you and me and all the people of God's kingdom. Let us pray. We give you thanks, God of majesty and mercy, for calling forth the creation and raising us from dust by the breath of your being. We bless you for the beauty and bounty of the earth, and for the day when sharing by all will mean scarcity for none. We remember the covenant you made with your people, and we give you thanks for all our ancestors in faith. We rejoice that you call us to reconciliation with you and all people everywhere, and that you remain faithful to your covenant, even when we are not. We rejoice that you call the entire human family to this table. We come in remembrance and celebration of the gift of Jesus Christ, who lived among us to reveal the mystery of your word, who suffered and died on the cross, and was raised from death on the third day. We give thanks, gracious God, for the presence of your Holy Spirit in the church you have gathered, and we ask you to send your Spirit on this bread and cup and on us. Strengthen our universal church, that it may be the champion of peace and justice in all the world. Restore the earth with your grace that is able to make all things new. Be present with us as we share this meal and throughout all our lives, that we may know you as the Holy One, who with Christ and the Holy Spirit lives forever. Amen. For on the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, telling them that in this bread was his body broken for them. And in the same manner, after the meal, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he poured it out and gave it to his disciples, telling them to take and drink. For in this cup is the new covenant of his blood, shed for the forgiveness of sins of all. As often as we do this in remembrance of him. The gifts of God for the people of God. Will the servers come forward? Open the bread end of the containers. Take and eat the body of Christ, broken for you. And now, if you'll open the Jew's end. Take and drink the blood of Christ, shed for the forgiveness of sins of all. Please stand for the prayer of thanksgiving.
Living God, by your Holy Spirit, you open our eyes to see the new light of this day. Open our lips to tell of the empty tomb. Open our hearts to believe the good news. We praise and thank you for the power of your saving love revealed in this sacrament and the resurrection of our Lord. As you have raised Jesus from the dead, give to us the gift of everlasting life, that we may glorify you forever through Christ, our risen Savior. Amen.
Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Let us do again. Alleluia. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Yes. And so we go out into the world to take the good news. We go in the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. One God, now and forever. Amen.